I told my lawn guy to go all out, put all the lights he could, light up the whole neighborhood. So here you go. So Merry Christmas. When 2019 comes up, Happy New Year. And make sure you subscribe to my channel. I need the money to pay my electric bill. We're at our secret garage and test facility. Let's see what we're rolling out today. Looks like a 2019 Subaru SUV to me. This is the all-new midsize Ascent. Assembled by American workers in Illinois, and they shipped it all the way from there to here, just for me and you. And like all Subarus, it has all-wheel drive or four-wheel drive traction. Symmetrical all-wheel drive. When I was told I was getting a Subaru, I assumed it was going to be one of those little dinky versions. As you can see, this is a lot larger. Price-wise, it's made to compete with midsize like Chevy Traverse, Ford Explorer, Honda Pilot, Toyota Highlander. In fact, I just completed a Chevy Traverse video last week and posted a video on YouTube. A lot of similarities, you should watch that. In fact, we'll have a link for that video coming up at the end of the Subaru video. The base price starts at $31,000. This was an upgraded premium version. Starting at $34,000 with a few extras, $36,630. There is an upgraded touring model around $44,000, but since this premium has about everything I think I would want, I'm not sure what's on the touring. I'm satisfied with this one myself. If you watch my videos, you know one of the first things we do is take the headlights out and see how they perform in the dark. This is a nice looking system. Let's see what it does. It's dark enough. Let's check out these headlights and see what they do. Here we have the low beams on a wall 100 feet away. Good height. Not the brightest light I've ever seen, but more than adequate. Go to high beam. Lights up pretty good there. If you're a cat lover, you'll like this neighborhood. Good lord, they're like rats. Here we have the brights on a building 300 feet away with a chain link fence in between. Good wide spread. Rather bright. Good low beam. Barely reaches out. More than adequate for city use, I would say. No complaints. Under the hood, we get a 2.4 liter turbocharged, horizontally opposed boxer engine. Don't see too many of those around, that's why it looks rather odd to you. It's a 2.4 liter turbocharged, four cylinder, putting out 260 horsepower at 5,600 RPM. 277 pounds-feet of torque at 2,000 RPM. Rated 21 mpg city, 27 highway, and 23 combined, they say. It's hooked to a CVT automatic, a transmission that most of us don't like, but it does have a manual shift override down here. And paddle shifters on the steering wheel, where they belong, not on the steering column where they don't belong like the Italians do, if you want to shift for yourself. If you're wondering what this is, I do believe this is the intercooler for the turbo. And I had some concerns with that because here's how it works. First, you have air that's going through the grill here. Then the air goes into these scoops, comes out through the scoop, and goes into the intercooler. That's the good news. The bad news is all the road debris, like dust, sand, rocks, also comes in through the scoops and clogs up the intercooler. If you look real close, there's all kinds of road debris I've been plucking out here. Leaves, small rocks. So I took it down to the Subaru dealer and said, what's the best way to clean this? And they go, I don't know. But I came up with a brilliant idea. If you can't pluck it out, suck it out. You'll be very happy to know this turbo engine runs on 87 octane. No need to use premium. That should save you some money. Let's take a look at the cabin, of which I am very impressed. We didn't get the leather, we got this nice cloth though. Not complaining. Good stuff. All the materials used in the workmanship, I can only say, is first class. The glove box is large enough, but only if you take out this monster size owner's manual that's thicker than a brick. Put it in a storage compartment in the back. Now we have room. More storage between the seats. A very simple to use climate control system. A well-designed gauge cluster with lots of useful information in between, including tire pressures, which are not registering at the moment. By pressing this info button, you can get more information up here. Once again, showing their brainless function, government bureaucrats rate this as an 8 passenger. Well, let's see. Driver, front passenger, that's 2. 3 adults in the second row, that's going to be a tight fit. Have to raise this, of course. Still a tight fit. That's 5, so I guess the other 3 fit in the third row. Once again, only if you're hauling monkeys. Officially, yes, it is an 8-seater, but realistically, 2 kids in the back. 3 kids here, 2 adults. And self-explanatory on the front here. Naturally, the third row seats do fold down for more storage, as well as the second row for even more storage. If you have the seats up, there's still more storage under here. Yes, you do get a spare tire, but if you get a flat, you're going to have the chore of crawling underneath in the dirt. Down under there. By the way, this is a good place to ditch that pesky owner's manual. Get it out of the way. If you take the 19 drink holders and divide by the 8 people we're supposed to fit in here, that's 2 drinks in each hand. Who are the extra 3 for? Yeah, it beats me. If you watch my videos, I have 2 complaints on many vehicles. First are the wide rocker panels under the door that cause your leg to rub on the bodywork and get dirt on you. Plus the dirt shelf bodywork they have where dirt collects. Fortunately, we don't have either of those issues on the Subaru. The body panel is rather narrow and all this stays clean, because the door comes all the way down. If you're driving in mud, snow, all of this stays dry and clean the way it should be on all vehicles. Other car manufacturers look at this and see how it's supposed to be done. Thank you, Subaru, for getting it right. On a scale of 1 to 10, I'm going to give Subaru a 10 for the cabin. I can't find anything to complain about. For the first half of this video, we did show and tell. Now we're going to do some driving and get some fuel economy figures as well. With a CVT automatic hooked up to a 4-cylinder engine, you might think this is a dog, but you'd be wrong. This is a very sensitive throttle, very responsive engine, and this vehicle moves out pretty good. Could snap your neck from a stoplight. Well, let's say snap your neck gently. Thing moves out pretty good. Nice brakes. Naturally, there's only me in here. If you load it up with these 8 people we're supposed to be carting around, I'm sure we'll slow down a bit. But still, this is a very responsive, smooth engine. No complaints. As we do in all of my videos, we're going to take some speed bumps around 25 miles per hour to gauge the impact with the suspension. Bump number one, comfortable enough. Number two, comfortable enough, felt it but not much. Number three, here comes the big nasty one. I would say about average. So as far as overall ride, I don't find the super plush stuff that some of these YouTubers are talking about, but still comfortable enough. So that's good enough for me, and probably will be for you. And again, anytime you move up from an 18-inch to a 20-inch wheel, you're going to lose the ride quality. If possible, I say stick with this size. The electric power steering has no feel. Then again, it's very light and quick and responsive. I don't think anyone's going to complain. Let's try the steering and suspension out on our turning circle that we usually reserve for sports cars. See what happens. Ooh, got some tire squealing going here. And some body lean. But we're still sticking to the pavement. And again, we do have all-wheel drive, so I would expect to. Not a sports car, but more than adequate for an SUV. No complaints. I put 107 miles for the past couple days, mainly in city traffic. Let's see what our fuel economy ended up being. It was 19.5 with all this drag racing and circling I've been doing. It dropped to 18.8. Still pretty good, I would say. This vehicle is reasonably quiet in city commuting, but if you have rough pavement like I'm on now, you get a lot of thumping noises on the wheels and tires. Once the pavement smooths out, though, you'll be okay. We're going to reset the mileage computer, get on the freeway, take a highway trip, see if we can boost the figures up a bit. So I'm driving down the freeway and I'm seeing a vehicle called the Duster. The Duster used to be a Chrysler product, but this obviously isn't. Does anyone out there in YouTube land know what a Duster SUV is and where it's from? I think it says Renault. Well, I'm passing that little Frenchman. We're going to be doing a freeway test, as I told you before, around 75 miles per hour. Here you go, 51 miles, 24.8 mpg. Not bad for a 2-ton rig. We're going to take a break from freeway driving to answer the question, can this Subaru be taken off pavement? Well, an SUV is not an SUV if it can't, and this definitely can with 8.7 inches of ground clearance. That front nose does stick out a bit, so you have to be careful when entering dips and look out for large rocks. But otherwise, as long as you realize this is basically a car, not a truck, you'll be just fine. And thanks to the Subaru all-wheel drive system, you have pretty good traction when going through soft sand like this. Naturally, it works just as good in snow, but I don't think we'll be seeing any snow around here, even though it is December. My ranch patrol duties are done. We're going to get on the freeway, do another fuel economy test. So here we go. Before we get on the freeway, we'll reset the mileage computer back to zero, of course. If you're in the habit of taking long highway trips, you might like this Subaru. It's reasonably comfortable, nice seats, low wind noise, great passing power. Once the turbo spools up, and it looks like we're getting pretty decent fuel economy on the return trip, since it's slightly downhill. We'll see when we pull over. We're back in town at the end of our trip. We're going to pull over and see what the fuel economy figures are. Well, here we go, 55 miles, 25.6 mpg. We're going to reset the computer and do a third fuel economy test. I promised you lots of miles, and that's exactly what we're going to do. Because of the Christmas holiday, we have a lot of idiots on the road blocking traffic. That means I've got to do a lot of passing, which also means our fuel economy figures are going to go down a bit. But the positive side is this turbo has lots of power for my passing. So who cares about fuel economy, right? All right, this trip was 117 miles that I put on, so you don't have to go to the expense of doing so. Let's see what our fuel economy was. 22.4. Not too bad considering the environment I was driving in. And before we wrap up this video, we'll have one more fuel economy test coming up. Don't go away. We're coming to the end of our last fuel economy drive. We did have a slight advantage because we're going downhill from 2,500 feet elevation to 1,000. Plus it's Christmas Eve, so traffic is light. Most people are out at Christmas parties getting drunk. I think we might get a pretty good figure this time. Here we go, 116 miles, 27 mpg. I think that's the best we're ever going to see. I've been driving this vehicle for a week. I can definitely say this is the nicest Subaru I've ever driven. In fact, this is one of the nicest SUVs I've ever driven. The Subaru engineers definitely did a good job on this. Unfortunately, I've reached my goal of 500 miles, so I'm going to have to give this back tomorrow. Hate to see it go. Well, this wraps up our Subaru test, and I have to stop this video because I'm still working on my house. That last hailstorm took the roof off and needs a little touch-up work. But hey, the Subaru doesn't have a sunroof, and my garage does. Can't complain about that, right? So here are some links to other vehicles we've tested. You want to see the videos, just click on the link and watch.